children, and don't let them fall by the side of the road. And teach them to love one another, that heaven might find a place in their hearts. 'Cause Jesus is love. He won't let you down, and I know we've got to walk on through temptation, 'cause he's love, and his wisdom will be our helping hand.
Good morning, or for my cholerics, good afternoon. Welcome. My name is Frank Cohen. I'm the lay pastor for our church here. And Paulette and Jorge have been part of our family for quite some time, so we are honored to be able to host this memorial service for Jorge. He was my friend. He was a good man. Era un buen hombre. And we will miss him terribly. You know, the saddest part is that because of his treatment, he was quite a high risk with regard to COVID, and so they weren't able to be here at church during the last almost year. And it's, I think the saddest part is that we have a number of people who are new to the church that never had a chance to meet him. So hopefully when we're done here, those folks will have a better idea of who he is. We have the program, just so you know, there's a couple changes to it. The testimonial is gonna come after the eulogy, so the eulogy will come first, then the testimonial. And in the testimony, if anybody else has anything they'd like to share, we ask that you come up front to do it, because we're gonna record this so that we can put a nice video together for family and friends that weren't able to attend here. We'll post that for everybody to see. So if you need anything at all, church members, raise your hands. See any of these folks here, Susan in the back, Bonita, Doris, myself. We want you to be as comfortable as possible, and make sure you have what you need. After we're done with the service, we have lunches for family and friends. Their boxed lunches, their chicken and some veggie ones, avocado for vegetarian folks, and some tea and other stuff. So you're welcome to stay. We have some tables set up out there, or if not, if you have to be somewhere or we had other plans, you're welcome to take a lunch with you and take, you know, to go. So we're gonna open with prayer. If you bow your heads with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so grateful today for the opportunity to come here before you, that we can be here as a family to lift up the memories and the joys of knowing Jorge. And Lord, I'd ask that we are able to spend our time here today, that the Holy Spirit would be here to open our hearts, and that we would remember those positive things and those good times, and that you would help comfort those who are mourning the loss, Lord. And that you would be here with us during our time today. I pray all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to open with a scripture reading. Usually, you know, someone will read a verse, but I'm not. I'm going to read 10 verses. So you'll have to put up with me for a minute on this. But it's important, because the first 9 of these verses give the foundational background for the 10th verse, which is what I want us to hear when I read it today. And then following the scripture reading, we're going to play a video that was produced by the funeral home, I believe. They did an amazing job. It's going to have some music and pictures. It's a reflective time. And we're all just going to just sit and enjoy yourself and sit quietly and you know, watch the video. So this comes from the book of Job. It's chapter 2. This actually begins the second test for Job. And it's verses 1 through 10. I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. It's a little more contemporary. It says, "One day the members of the heavenly court came again to present themselves before the Lord, and the accuser, Satan, came with them. 'Where have you come from?' the Lord asked Satan. Satan answered the Lord, 'I have been patrolling the earth, watching everything that's going on.' And then the Lord asked Satan, 'Have you noticed my servant Job? He is the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God and stays away from evil, and he has maintained his integrity, even though you urged me to harm him without cause.' Satan replied to the Lord, 'Skin for skin, a man will give up everything he has to save his life. But reach out and take away his health, and he will surely curse you to your face.' 'All right, do with him as you please,' the Lord said to Satan, 'but spare his life.' So Satan left the Lord's presence, and he struck Job with terrible boils from head to foot. Job scraped his skin with a piece of broken pottery as he sat among the ashes. And his wife said to him, 'Are you still trying to maintain your integrity? Curse God and die.'" And here's the verse I want you to listen to. Verse 10 says, "But Job replied, 'You talk like a foolish woman. Should we accept only good things from the hand of God and never anything bad?' So in all this, Job said nothing wrong." Amen. Bonita? We're not the hotbed of technical capabilities and qualifications here, so I apologize in advance for that. We're going to go ahead and start with the eulogy. Morgan is going to come up. And I'll be right here if you need me.
Jorge Iglesias Austrich was born in Cuba's capital city of Havana to Jaime Jesus Austrich and Piedad Iglesias Austrich on April 19, 1949. The eldest of what would soon become a family of six. At 8 years of age, he excitedly left the island with his parents and younger sisters, Lillian and Susie, for the land of rock and roll and the Wild West. The family attained temporary residency in Santa Rosa, New Mexico, where his father secured a job as an insurance underwriter. Several years later, they would return to Cuba so his mother could deliver her fourth child, Gonzalo, amongst close family and friends. At age 13, Jorge, his parents, and his siblings would once again make their way to the United States, landing in Miami, Florida in 1963. Lured from Florida to Maryland for a lucrative position with Maryland Casualty, now Zurich Insurance, Jaime Austrich and his family would settle in Baltimore, where Jorge would graduate high school from Baltimore's renowned City College before returning to Florida to attend Miami-Dade College and the University of Miami. After marrying his college sweetheart, Jorge returned to Baltimore, where his son, Jamie, was born, and he began working for Maryland State Road Commission, now Maryland State Highway. Jorge would later obtain his Bachelor's of Science for Business Administration from Towson University and go on to maintain several high-profile positions at Maryland's Department of Economic Development. As director of their small business programs, he received awards and honors for his successful initiatives and was heralded nationally as one of the country's top Hispanics in business and technology. In 2000, Jorge met the love of his life, Paulette Pettit, a Baltimore native freshly transplanted from New York City, whom he would wed in 2003. The couple would later move from their leafy Arcadia neighborhood in Baltimore to Tampa, Florida in late 2015, upon Jorge's retirement from the state of Maryland, after 30 years of public and private service. He is survived by his wife of 18 years, Paulette Pettit Austrich, son Jamie Austrich, Aunt Josefina Austrich, daughter-in-law Candace Austrich, granddaughters Madison and Morgan Austrich, siblings Lillian Bowie Austrich, Susie Hatch, and James Gonzalo Austrich, along with numerous nieces, nephews, and cousins. Words cannot express the depth of our love and admiration and gratitude. You are our rock, our champion, our hero. We love you so much, Abuela. You will forever live in our hearts.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Morgan. And I think Madison, we're going to have a time for testimonials. Come on. Madison's going to start out, and then Jamie is going to come up. And after that, if anybody here has anything they'd like to share, we would certainly welcome that, and you're welcome to come up front to do that if you'd like to. Thank you.
Hello. We share this room today to celebrate the life of my grandfather, whose deep care and compassion for others undoubtedly touched everyone he met and likely many people in this room. It is taking time for me to process this tremendous loss. Everywhere I go, I feel both his presence and his absence. I keep reaching for my phone to call him, knowing he would brighten my day with his favorite greeting. Hello, my beautiful granddaughter, how are you? In my childhood, I always loved my abuelo, but our bond grew much stronger once I moved far from home for college. No matter when I called, no matter what they were doing, abuelo and Paulette would talk with me for long stretches of time. Looking back on these conversations now, I realize how much of an impact their continuous support made, helping me feel at home when I was 2,000 miles away in New York and 5,000 miles away in Hawaii. Whenever I was anxious or lacking confidence about my ability to achieve something, abuelo always had the same response. Of course you can do this. You know why? You're an ostrich. There were no qualifications, no you can do this because of this, or you can do this despite that. It was always just you can. You can because you're you, and you can because you're an ostrich. The way he said that, I always knew it was something to be proud of. Abuelo gave all of us so much, but specifically for my sister and I, he gave us confidence. He gave us strength. He showed us to work hard where it counts and to save time for the things that really matter in life. He taught us about our Cuban heritage, emphasized the importance of activism and staying informed about what's going on in the world. And he brought us closer to God with his passion for his faith and for his community. He also gave Morgan and I our deeply kind, resilient, and lovely grandmother, Paulette. We are both so grateful for you. As I said at the beginning, I am still trying to acclimate to this new reality. My abuelo was sick and fighting for 4 years. Thank you. And yet his death was something we could never be ready for. I keep revisiting a conversation I had with him just a few weeks before he died. He had wanted to know where I thought he should be buried, where we would want to go to visit him. My response was, no matter where you are, whether you're physically buried here or your ashes are in an urn there, I know you're going to be with me. I know you'll be with us wherever we are. Now that he has passed, I know this to be true. He is here now with us. I will be with each of us when we step out that door. I know he's here because when I wasn't sure if I could control my emotion enough to deliver this speech, I heard a familiar voice say, "Of course you can. You're an ostrich." Thank you for everything, abuelo. Te quiero mucho. We will miss you. And we are here with you. Thank you.
Thank you. Jamie, whenever you're ready.
That's not fair, because now I'm crying again. thanks everyone for coming. I know a lot of you came a long ways driving and airplanes and the rest of it, and to everyone out there, we know why you're not here, and we appreciate all your thoughts and prayers. One of my first memories of my dad, you kind of got a glimpse of, was him playing the conga and the flute as a front man in his Latin rock band. It was in the basement of our house in Baltimore, and I was, you know, somewhere between 3 and 4 years old, and there'd be loud music emanating from the basement door, and I, of course, had to go check it out. I can still see him in his bell bottoms and his long hair, and you saw the beard. So I've got proof. My dad, he taught me a lot about this world. Like his father, my dad had the gift of gab. Probably everybody in this room knows that. He could make friends anywhere he went. You can track his history by the friends you see. There are people in there that he met in college, before college, at work, after work, and he always maintained those bonds. And candidly, that gift has been, I appreciate it every day, because I feel like he gave it to me, and but for that, I wouldn't be where I am today. He taught me to love. Little things and big things. Taught me to love the Beatles. We can debate whether that's big or little. He taught me to love music. He taught me to love art. Taught me to love history. The Baltimore Orioles. Blue crabs and Maryland crab cakes. Tried to teach me to love fishing. It didn't take. Sorry, Dad. But he tried. He tried. But more importantly, my dad taught me to be tolerant and accepting and loving of all people, different cultures and ideas. My dad taught me to appreciate the beauty and the diversity of the human experience. And that's not an easy thing these days. And he maintained that way long ago, and or started that, you know, as early as I can remember, and obviously maintained that throughout his life. Simply put, he taught me to love and not to hate. For that, I will be forever grateful. He loved his family fiercely. He loved his wife. He loved my wife. He loved our daughters and all his brothers and sisters and his cousins. He always cherished every moment with them and his friends. He was so proud of his granddaughters. It was his favorite topic in the world. He taught me to love my family and my friends as fiercely as well. So my dad had a bit of a non-traditional approach to parenting. I'm going to put it in perspective. When he had me, he was about 21 years old. So he was a young man himself. And I remember one of the first summers I can remember with him, when after my parents had divorced, was at a log cabin up in Maryland. And it was him and a bunch of his roommates. So I want you to imagine he must have been 26 at the time, and a bunch of other 26-year-old guys. Basically, it was a bunch of college kids living together. And I refer to it as the hippie frat house. It wasn't quite National Lampoon's Animal House, but it was certainly an educational experience for me. I also spent a lot of time with my dad at the University of Miami. He lived in student housing there, and with a roommate, Ricardo, who's a good friend from Colombia, and who remains quite the character, and who shared many crazy moments with my dad, with me to witness. He took me to the student union when I was like 10. We saw a bunch of movies, like I'll never forget, he took me to see the Yellow Submarine, which is pretty much a psychedelic experience. He took me to see the blood-curdling Enter the Dragon, a Bruce Lee movie. And this one probably had the most, the biggest impact on me. He took me to see When Our Stranger Calls. I had a little difficulty sleeping after that one. He also took me to several college parties. Yeah, before I was 12, I had been to several college parties. Now, this may seem a bit out there, and I'm not being critical of my dad's parenting style. There's a consistent theme here that remained true my whole life. He loved me. And not only loved me, he always wanted me to be with him. And he wanted me to experience the world, whether I was ready for it or not. He was genuine. He didn't suffer superficiality. And to him, to leave me with some babysitter or to not take me that week or whatever, that wasn't real. That was his life, and he was going to live it, and he was going to live it with me. And I appreciate that. It was a hallmark of him: truth, honesty, sincerity. I always knew that I could count on his genuine self, never a doubt. This allowed us to always have a close bond, no matter how many miles or months separated us. He was also very supportive. You heard Madison say that he was always, you know, inflating her with confidence and instilling that in her. He did the same for me. He never substituted his judgment for my own. He never undermined my confidence. Sorry. He never tried to stand in my way. He was always respectful of my opinions, even when they differed from his, and my decisions. I remember one time I came home from college, and I wanted to switch majors. And my dad wasn't particularly thrilled about the idea, so he tried to persuade me to stick it out, stay with the major that I was already in. But when I made my decision, which was to change, he never brought it up again. Supported me 100%. I never once heard about that day again from him. And he always, he knew what was important was what made me happy. What did I want to do? It was never about his ego or his feelings when it had to do with my life. He respected me and always supported me in what I was trying to accomplish. Now, I love that story for another reason. If I told you that the two majors that were up for debate were business and music, you'd probably think the young college student was trying to switch from business to music, and that the older father was saying, no, son, don't throw away your life on business, or music, you should stick to business. No, it was exactly the opposite. I was a music major, and I was wanting to switch to business, and my dad at the time thought that's what would make me happiest, was music. And so he was looking out for me, and he may have been right, who knows, but all I know is that he was there to support me no matter what it was. That's the kind of man he was. I tried to do the same for my girls and support them in anything they do, and that's because of him, girls. My dad also taught me the power of positivity. When he was first diagnosed with multiple myeloma 4 years ago, I remember being in the doctor's office with him. The prognosis was confirmed. It was terminal and it was not treatable. It was just a matter of time. And there could be a wide window there. And my dad, it was a hard day. It was difficult news. My dad, took it in stride. And never lost faith, never lost hope. And what I loved about it is he could always, even in the most difficult moments, make you smile. He dubbed that Dr. Doom, made him sound like a Marvel comic book character. And forever thereafter, every time we saw him, it was, "Good morning, Dr. Doom, how are you doing?" And Dr. Shames would laugh and chuckle and got a big kick out of that, and it would set the tone because, you couldn't change what was going to be said in that room. You just had to have a positive attitude about it, and that's how we got through things. And he beat that multiple myeloma. That is not what took him from us. Many years he survived. And that taught me a lesson. It taught me a very difficult lesson about, how do you face such a daunting task. He and Paulette plowed through those treatments and the procedures, and they never gave a hint of losing faith or hope. And I thank her for being there for him for that. He just, you know, you were a source of unending inspiration for him. It was awe-inspiring, and I would never forget it. He beat that prognosis. Little did I know that it was a lesson that I was going to need so soon. I faced my own cancer diagnosis a couple of years later. And after watching my dad go through it, I knew exactly what I had to do. And thanks to my wife and my girls, that's what I did. He taught me the power of positivity. He taught me the power of being brave. He showed me how to be fearless in the face of something so fearful. I will always and forever be grateful to him for that. He will be forever in our hearts. And along those same lines, I would close with a message of positivity. My dad would want everyone here to take the joy that it was to know him and keep it forever in your hearts. To not be sad that he is gone, but to feel joy that we knew and loved him. Dad, I will always love and cherish all the time we had together on this earth. I know right now you're dancing the salsa up with the angels and looking down on us as you reunite with family and friends and make new friends, I'm sure. I love you, Dad. And until we meet again, I will always miss you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie. Thank you, Jamie. And Madison and Morgan, appreciate it. And if anybody else wants to share it, now is a good time. I can tell you that I knew Jorge for years, not decades. But many of the things that you said held true here at this church. He left a trail of friends as well. And the whole time that I knew him, that he was going through his struggle with cancer, I never heard him complain. I'm trying to think. Not one time did I ever hear anything that was negative. Not one time did I ever hear him bemoan the situation that he was in or his health. I mean, and there were days, you got to know, when he came here to church and he was not feeling well. You could tell, you know. And, you know, Jamie, you should know that he was more concerned about your cancer diagnosis than his the whole time. You know, if he ever asked for prayer, it wasn't for him, it was for you. So he was a model person. He was a good man. We loved Jorge. He was a very important member of our church family here. You know, when he first came in, he definitely had some trepidation. He was a bit uncertain. And, you know, and he kept coming back and he would ask questions and engage in conversations. And, you know, he had a brilliant mind. I think that was what I really loved about him. He would intellectualize this process of belief, but he didn't over-intellectualize it. He didn't think beyond what was necessary to come to a solution. So he would contemplate, process the information, he would make a decision, and he would move on. I mean, I think that, I wish I could do that. It would make my life a lot less complicated, but I could see that in him in just the short time that he was here. You know, life is about fractals as well, and the short period that Jorge spent with us, I'm sure, was nothing more than a representation of the long periods that he spent with other people and the time that he spent with them. So even though I didn't know him for decades, it felt like that. And I'm grateful that he was here with us. So thank you. Susan?
I'm Susan, and I just wanted to say real quickly, I heard the word good a lot, and I know he was a good man. I heard stories from Paulette saying how he helped people get a second chance, and so many times he didn't overlook things. But I just wanted to mention faith when I'm up here, because I saw such a strong faith in him. And, you know, good is good. But God also wants to know us and have a relationship. And I saw that faith that he had. And, you know, we're all from different backgrounds, beliefs, whatever here. But this scripture came to my mind this morning, and it said, "The hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him." And I just wanted to say that his ability, even a couple of weeks ago, we called one day to check, and we heard him in the background, "Tell Frank I'm ready to check out." You know, he just like this, "Tell Frank I'm ready to check out." And it's like, your heart is breaking. You can barely stand it. And here he is in the background with this little quip, you know. And I also, nobody does death perfectly. It's not in the plan. We weren't created to die terrible, horrible deaths from disease. I mean, it's just wasn't the plan here. And so I know many times Paulette was questioning himself. Am I doing this right? Am I doing that? I said, we can't do it all right. He knows you love him, even though you're in his face bugging him, "Drink your water, do this. You know, he knows you love him in the middle of all that. But I think the moment for me was a week or two ago when I stopped by, and they had come for hospice care, and I walk in, and she said, "Well, how do you just sit here?" That's what they say. "I'm just supposed to sit here and not do anything. How do you do that?" You know, and I think in the bigger picture, there's so much going on in this world. We have people that would have liked to have been here today, their younger sister, you know. I know that Natalie's sending her love to you. She's off to a funeral there. There's so much tragedy, it seems, in somebody's lives that how do we do that and not try to fix it and be in the middle of it and make it work? And I think that comes back to the faith that I learned from Jorge. You know, it's like, it is what it is. It's time to go. And I know he didn't do it perfectly either, and I'm sure there were days, you know, we're human. But the overall message from him was faith that, you know, God's got this, and we need to let go. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. Delia, please.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
When I met Jorge, he reminded me of 1 Corinthians chapter 13. "Though I speak with the tongue of men or angels, I have not love. I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, I have no love, I'm nothing. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have no love, it profits me nothing. Charity suffers, which is love. Love suffers long and is kind. Envious not. Mounts not itself, is not puffed up, does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we know through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even I am also known. And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three things. But the greatest of these is love." And he was an example of love. May God bless each one of you.
Thank you, Delia. And I know it's uncomfortable for people to come up front, but we don't want to press you, but feel free.
Good afternoon. My name is Bill Villanueva. Paulette, you have my deepest condolences, Jaime, and your family. But let me tell you a little bit about how Jorge impacted my family. Years ago, I was this growing business, I thought tycoon guy, and I grew my business, and along that way, I met Jorge. And Jorge had this way of kind of just touching you, and I remember I wound up working on a couple of projects, and one of the projects that were outside of my business was with the Latino business community. And whether it was starting the Baltimore Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, the Maryland Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, his beloved Maryland, or the Centro de la Comunidad, or the Maryland Hispanic Business Conference, he was there. He loved his roots. He loved the Latino business community, and he loved business. He had an entrepreneurial mind. You know, I went on to close down my business, and I started running companies. And at one point, I messed up my leg and had to leave that position. And I was out of work for quite a while. And I was hurt. And I remember, you know, I talked to Jorge, and when everyone else kind of gave me their back, Jorge hired me. And he took us out of a really bad way. That's the type of man he was. He had a heart bigger than you'll ever know. So, and I heard a lot about you, Jaime, and your family. Your abuelo was tremendous. I'm a former musician, and so that's why we meshed so much, you know. I'd be like, "Kimbara, kimbara, kimbara, kimama," and he'd be like, "Kimbara, kimbara, kimbara." So it was kind of, like that. And so, you know, when he got sick, we came down and we spent some time the first time around. And I just, you know, I saw him fighting, and he got better. And you know, I thought he was just doing great. And then when I got that message, the impact was deep. But I want to say, folks like Luis Borunda, Deputy Secretary of the State of Maryland, Julio Parra, Carmen Larson, Maria Rodriguez, they all send their condolences to you and you and your family. We all will miss. He will be well missed. And I will leave you with Psalms 116:15 that says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." Amen. And he will be well missed. Well missed. I want to thank you. God bless you. You have our deepest condolences from La Familia Villanueva. God bless you.
Thank you. We okay? Everybody okay? All right. So I'm going to talk for a few minutes. A short few minutes, I promise. I think the only time I ever really came to terms with Jorge was once when I asked him, "Es Puerto Riqueño?" That was a mistake. I learned later that I should have thought that one out first. I started with this verse, or I ended with this in the scripture reading. And it says, shall we indeed accept good from God, and shall we not accept adversity? This is a tough one, you know. We're going to talk a little bit about it today, but we get into the situation about why bad things happen to good people. And I think that if we don't understand the importance of the providence of God, if we haven't built that relationship, that it's easy to become angry and bitter. And that is another cancer that eats away at people and destroys lives. So I wanted to talk a little bit today about that, maybe to take on from what Susan mentioned about faith. I was born and raised Jewish, and my grandparents were Yiddish speakers. And there's a Yiddish saying, and it says, God plucked, Iman locked. And it means God plans and man plans and God laughs, is what it's about. Because we were talking about it actually today, about this inability that we have to predict the future. That's always been a desire of human beings, all the way back to the beginning of time. I'm a mathematician, and if you study the old philosophers who are also the mathematicians, and many times with the clergy, their whole purpose of math was to be able to predict human behavior. And we know now that that's just an impossibility. We were actually talking about it today at church. If you went back 6 years or 5 or 6 years and someone said to you, hey, tell me where you're going to be in 5 years, you know, and who would have said we're going to be locked down in our house, not being able to go out, having to wear masks, and we can't find any toilet paper, right? And so we have that stress and anxiety of not knowing what the future brings, you know. Even in times when we're given a diagnosis of a terminal diagnosis, we don't know the time and the day and when those things are going to happen. And so there's this sense of anxiety and tension that we have to live with. And we have to find ways to diffuse that, or else it becomes a burden, not just on us, but on our family. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. And maybe one of the interpretations of that, well, I know that when I was baptized and I came up out of the water, I thought that the world would change. I thought that driving up and down US 19 here, that people would go, whoa, Frank's a Christian now. Move over and give him some room, you know. Don't be mean to him or cut him off because he's a Christian. I thought I would have some glow about me, but that wasn't true. Nor was it realistic, because it our coming to faith doesn't change the world, it changes us. It doesn't change how other people treat us necessarily, but it changes how we are able to adapt to how things have been or how they were. It says a lot about our relationships with Christ and life as a Christian. But there's also a lot of things that it doesn't say in this verse. What Paul is not saying here is that only good things happen to Christians. That's not what that verse says. Romans 8:18 says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed to us." It doesn't say that God works everything out for our comfort. It's not what it says. In fact, in 2 Corinthians 1:3-4, it says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation." Now, the next line doesn't say so that we can be comfortable. It says that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. How many of you in here have lost a loved one before? And yet, here you are. So somehow, you made it through the other side with your faith intact. Am I right? And that happens. God comforts us in those times so that when someone like Paulette or Jamie or your family experience this loss, that those who have been through it are in a position to comfort them with the same comfort that they were given when they went through that situation. You know, I'm going to paraphrase this from another organization, but it says that the therapeutic value of one person who's been through this helping another is without parallel. That a person who's experienced suffering can best understand and help another person who's been going through that same suffering. So we need to, I think, lower our expectations a bit about, because it's not about us. You know, what I can tell you is that you don't have to worry about Paulette, because our job in this church now is to make sure that she has what she needs. God's blessed us in ways so that we can bless people back like that. But here's what that verse does say. It says that these things, these sufferings and things, are limited only to the time we spend here on this earth. You know, this is a conversation that Jorge and I had several times. You know what's funny is I got some calls from florists, and they said, "We have some flowers to deliver for a memorial service for George Austrich." I'm like, "George? Who's George?" You know? And I'd never heard him called George before. I never pictured him. And you're right, he was very proud of his heritage. So I'm like, "Put Jorge on there." Don't put George on that. Put Jorge. We would have conversations about this, and here's what we would come to. That we believed that we could tolerate anything for the rest of our lives as long as we didn't have to take it into eternity with us. That whatever suffering that Jorge had to go through, he knew that he could handle it here because he knew that it was temporary. John 16:33 says, "In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Maybe it's a problem, maybe it's not, but life is not always fair. I remember in high school playing football, and it was our homecoming, my senior year. So it would be the last homecoming that I would play there. And we were playing this other team that was actually from a town called Bad Axe, Michigan. And they whomped us. It was like 33-0. And we went into the locker room after the game was over, and Jim Waldo, that was our coach, Coach Waldo, and, you know, we were kind of demoralized, and everybody was sitting around quietly. Nobody said anything. And I spoke up, and I said, "You know, Coach," because he was a good Christian man, and I was not at the time. And I said, "You know, Jim, we prayed to win." And he said, "So did they." That was my first lesson in the divinity and the providence of God. I learned a lesson that day that I still have to work on sometimes. Maybe some of you share this, but it's not about me. In my work, I would sometimes have to testify as an expert in court cases. And my uncle, Jerry Cohen, was a very prominent, famous attorney at one time. And we were having a Thanksgiving dinner, and we were talking about this litigation support work. And I said, you know, how do you go in there as an expert witness and do a good job? And he said, there were four things, but the first thing he said to me was this. He said, it's not about you. You check your ego at the door, you know? And I didn't understand, I guess, what he meant at that time. But it felt like things were not fair. And the truth is, life isn't fair. Bad things happen to good people. And don't ask me to tell you why, because I don't necessarily know the answer to that. I can tell you this, that in several years ago here in St. Petersburg, there was a domestic dispute, and a police officer was shot and killed as a part of that. And so the news crews were all down there, and the chief of police showed up, and one of the reporters, you know, shoved the microphone into the chief's face, and he said, why do you think this happened? Can you explain this? What went wrong? He said that this officer got killed. And this police chief said something I never expected to hear on the news. And he said, we live in a fallen world. And so life is not fair. And bad things do happen to good people. Peter was released and James was stoned to death. Did they pray for both of them? Yes, the saints prayed for both of them. John the Baptizer was beheaded. John the Apostle was cast to Patmos. Job lost everything, and he did nothing wrong. He was just part of a plan to set an example to show how loyal and faithful God's subjects would be to him. Jesus was hung on the cross. If that's not the ultimate example of how unfair life can be, maybe we need to not whine and complain so much, and not bemoan the situations that we're in. This is it. Get used to it. It is what it is. I don't necessarily like that expression all the time, but this is, you know, I remember Susan told me one time I was having a real problem with the situation going on. She said, look down. You know, I looked and said, what do you see? I said, I see my feet. And where are they? They're right here. And she said, that's right. You are where you are at the time, and we need to accept the fact that this is just the way life is. Nobody comes into this world wanting to get sick and go out. It's just not what it's about. But we're not in control of the outcome of all those. We're not, as my mom used to say, that she was the chairman of the results committee, and that's just not the case. But not only do bad things happen to good people, but what makes it more infuriating sometimes is that good things happen to bad people. And we have to ask ourselves, why? Barabbas was set free instead of Jesus, who did nothing wrong. Barabbas, who was a known, convicted, recidivist killer and a criminal, was set free. Zacchaeus prophet, Rehoboam, inherited riches and power. Matthew 5:45 says this, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust. Here's the deal. God is good all the time. Romans 8:35-39, one of my favorite verses, says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded, now listen, that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's pretty powerful. Amen. Let me ask you something. What's the mortality rate with people for people with cancer. It's 100%. What's the mortality rate for people who don't have cancer? It's 100%, right? You know, I had a speaking to a group of younger folks one time, which I guess at my age could have been 50, but they were kids. And I asked them this question, you know, who wants to go to heaven? And they all raised their hands. I said, who wants to go now? And they all raised their hands. And I said, who wants to die right now? And nobody raised their hands. And we're missing a key part of this, is that there's a rite of passage. We can't be afraid of death because it comes to all of us. Even in the end times, in that transformation, we die of ourselves, of who we are, and transformed into new people. Jesus comes and the dead arise in Christ and are taken up with him. There's nothing we can do to avoid it. Solomon once said in, I'm not going to be able to quote the verse, so I apologize. But he said we should spend more time contemplating funerals than parties. I'm paraphrasing. And you think that seems a little morose, but it's not, because we spend all of our time thinking about life and living and not thinking about eternity and what we need to do now to be prepared for it. We plan and God laughs. We have no idea how much more time any of us have. I can't predict that. There may not be a 5 years for me to predict in the future, or even 24 hours. I need to be ready now. Life is all about what we do here and what we do to help prepare those we leave behind for an eternity of family and friendship. And Susan's right. When we would call, I would hear Jorge in the background. You know, light her up, he'd say. Let her ready. It's time to go. When a couple weeks ago, when we came over and had dinner with Jorge and Paulette, you know, he was not in a good way. And, you know, I knew he felt uncomfortable about it. And we finally got him up to the table and he was eating with us. And he said, don't wait for me. Matter of fact, don't ever wait for me, is what he said. I'm ready, he said, at a moment's notice. You know, he was a brave guy. You know, that really took, in what we would call genuine chutzpah, you know, it really did. We need to pray that we'll spend what time we have left here preparing ourselves. We have to do that first, you know. We can't help prepare other people until we're prepared first. And our friends and our families to spend eternity together. And the place is going to be a lot better than what we're seeing here. There's no pain, no suffering, no tears, no riots, no starvation, no none of that when we get to heaven. I'm going to close with this. This is sort of an anonymous message that was published in this magazine a long time ago. Because I don't have the answers to life. Don't look to me. I'm not some guru up here where you can come up afterwards and say, what's the meaning of life? Or why do we suffer? Or why do good things happen to bad people? Hey, I don't know. I know as much as you do about that. I just know that I trust and believe that God is in control no matter what. And that is what gives me the strength to go on sometimes from day to day. You know, the one day at a time, you've heard that expression. Sometimes it's a moment at a time when things are really tough and in crisis. And we just cannot give up. We just can't stop. I have a friend who said it to me this way. He said, don't give up 5 minutes before the miracle. That's what he said. Because you don't ever know when that's going to happen. Prayer is the answer to every problem in life. It puts us in touch with the divine wisdom, which knows how to adjust everything perfectly. So often we do not pray in certain situations because, from our standpoint, the outlook is hopeless. But nothing is impossible with God. Nothing so tangled it cannot be remedied. No human relationship is so strained for God to bring about reconciliation and understanding. No habit so deep-rooted that it cannot be overcome. No one is so weak that he cannot be made strong, or so ill that he cannot be healed. No mind is so dull that it cannot be made brilliant. Whatever we need, if we trust in God, he will supply it. If anything is causing worry or anxiety, let us stop rehearsing the difficulties. Hear that? Memorize that line. Let us stop. You know, here's the problem with rehearsing the difficulty. If it happens, you got to live it twice. If it doesn't happen, you had to go through it and you didn't have to. Stop rehearsing the difficulty and trust God for healing, love, and power. Amen? Amen. I'm going to close. It's in the traditional way that I close. It's how my abuela closed. My grandfather would on when the Sabbath was over. And it's from Numbers. And it's what's called often the Aaronic blessing. I'm going to recite it in Hebrew, and then I'll do it in English as well. If you bow your heads with me. Yivrecha Adonai v'yishmerecha ya'ar Adonai panav alecha v'ikunecha. Yisa Adonai panav alecha v'yashem lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and bring you peace. Amen. And thank you, everybody, for coming here, for not our church members, but for friends and family. How do we do this, Susan?
Right out through that. Well, they can visit for a little bit.
Yeah, hang out. We're in no hurry, guys. We're not shutting this place down, so you do what you have to do. When you're ready, you go through this door. There are box lunches there. There's chicken and there's vegetarian, and there's some eclairs and tea to drink, and you can take it out. Because of COVID, I'm so tired of that word, but because of COVID, we can't eat inside here. So we have tables set up out in the breezeway, and today with gusts to 21 miles an hour, it is definitely a breezeway. So it should be a little more comfortable out there, and you can take your lunches out there and sit and visit. Or if you have some place to go, you're welcome to take them with you to wherever it is you have to be. So that's it for me. Is everybody okay? Are we all right? How about a deep breath? Let's do that. Okay. Paulette, anything that you, we missing anything? You want to say anything? Or? All right. Well, we love you, and we are here for you. We are want to be your family and take care of you. So thank you, everybody.
Love is the answer. most you